A chiller is a cooling device which transfers thermal energy from one place to another. It is usually used for providing space cooling, and its principle is based on the refrigeration cycle, or you can call it the reverse Carnot cycle. The chiller process consists of several thermodynamic processes, and it requires refrigerants to work. And basically, there are two types of chillers. So we have the compression chillers and the absorption chiller. So the main difference between the compression chiller and the absorption chiller, as shown in this schematic here, is that the compression chiller uses mechanical compressors, while the absorption chiller uses a thermal compressor. So the mechanical compressor is usually driven by an electric motor, which provides the work input that drives the heat transfer from the low temperature to the high temperature. So in this case, it means that this compressor is the prime mover, which uses the pressure differential, the pressure changes between the incoming and the exit, the pressure differential, to circulate the refrigerant around the system. Basically, there are different types of compressors that we can use to achieve this purpose. We could either use a centrifugal compressor, or a rotary compressor, or either a reciprocating compressor. So how does the compression chiller works? The refrigerant enters this compressor at gaseous state and at a low temperature and pressure. And then it leaves the compressor with a high pressure and temperature, which is the purpose of compression. The refrigerant then enters the condenser, still at its gaseous state. The temperature of the refrigerant is then reduced inside this condenser as heat is removed from the refrigerant. So the condenser is typically a heat exchanger. So you have the coolant fluid coming in. So I could just give a description here. Coolant fluid coming and leaving. However, the coolant fluid does not mix with the refrigerant. So it could use a shell and tube heat exchanger to achieve that purpose. The refrigerant then leaves the condenser at a reduced temperature and a relatively constant pressure. However, the pressure will be mainly determined if there are losses within the condenser. And typically in a real scenario, there will be 1 or 2% losses in that pressure. And then it goes into the expansion valve at a low temperature, a relatively constant pressure, and then it leaves the expansion valve at a lower temperature and pressure. So because this is an expansion process, ideally, so within this expansion valve, the refrigerant is expanded, reducing its pressure and with an increase in the volume of the refrigerant, which allows it to pick up heat energy as it goes into the evaporator. So in the evaporator, again, it acts like a heat exchanger where you have the fluid for the space cooling going into the evaporator and then leaves the evaporator. And thereby, the coolant releases its heat energy to the refrigerant. So the refrigerant gains temperature while it exits the evaporator. And once this is done, the refrigerant becomes gaseous. And then it enters again into the compressor. And the process repeats itself. So this is how the compression chiller works. On the other side, the absorption chiller uses a thermal compressor, which is a combination of a generator and an absorber. Basically, the generator can utilize low temperature from waste heat or solar heat supply, which gives it an edge over the compression chiller, and it makes the absorption chiller more sustainable. However, in terms of performance, the compressor chiller is more energy efficient than the absorption chiller. But the selling point of the absorption chiller is the ability to use heat as its driving force. So which means we can use low waste heat to drive the generator. Why the compression chiller is more efficient than the absorption chiller? It's because of the number of components. The more components you have, the more losses you would encounter and the less efficient the system could be. So, how does the absorption chiller work? Before we discuss on how the absorption chiller works, it is important we know that both processes uses refrigerant and coolant as its working fluid for the overall cooling purpose. It is also important that we understand the absorption process and some terms associated with it. Certain substances have attraction for each other as such that one of the substance could easily dissolve in the other when they come in contact. The absorbent absorbs the other substance. An example of an absorbent is sodium chloride, which has strong affinity for water. So an absorbent could be solid, liquid, gas, or other substances. For the absorption chiller, it is then important that we select good combination of the absorbent and the refrigerant. There are several absorbents and refrigerant combinations that can be used in the absorption chiller. So we could either use lithium bromide and water, where the lithium bromide is the absorbent and the water is the refrigerant. We could also use ammonia and water combination, where the ammonia is the refrigerant and water is the absorbent. There are other refrigerant and absorbent combination that can be used, which will be discussed in my next video. The working fluid combination would have an effect on the structure and the sizing of the absorption chiller. And that's why it's important you have an understanding of the behavior of each of the absorption chiller, absorbent, and refrigerant that you will be using. So the absorption chiller system consists of the generator, the absorber, the condenser, the evaporator, And then we have two valves. One is the expansion valve, and the other valve is located in between here, which is the solution valve. As well, we have a pump that is used to pump in the solution of lithium bromide and water through the heat exchanger into the generator. Similar to the compressor chiller, a refrigerant is the medium of exchange throughout the whole cycle thermodynamic process. So if we use, for example, lithium bromide and water, water will be the refrigerant circulating throughout this process, and why the lithium bromide will be the absorbent, absorbing the water during the heat exchange process. With this in mind, within the system, we have the absorber and the evaporator as the low pressure side, while we have the generator and the condenser as the high pressure side. So starting from the absorber, inside the absorber, we have a solution of water and lithium bromide, which is pumped to raise its pressure and transfers the solution from the absorber to the generator. As the solution enters the generator, the temperature is raised from the heat source into the solution of the lithium bromide and water. Hence, the water in the solution leaves the generator in vapor or gaseous state to the condenser, while the remaining lithium bromide in the generator returns to the absorber through connecting pipes. This heat exchanger here is used to transfer heat from the weak mixture going into the generator and the concentrated solution returning to the absorber in order to reduce the heat energy requirement for boiling the refrigerant in the generator, as well as pre-cooling the absorbent solution, which in turn reduces the required flow rate of cooling fluid through the absorber. Now, the high pressure and temperature water vapor enters the condenser through connecting pipes, and within the condenser, the heat from the water vapor is absorbed and converted into liquid. Just like we talked in the compression chiller, same process happens here. So you have a cooling medium coming in and also leaving the condenser. This can be achieved either using air or water as the external cooling medium. This reduces the temperature of the refrigerant as it leaves the condenser, and then it goes into the expansion valve, where the pressure is reduced and temperature decreases. The low temperature and pressure refrigerant then goes into the evaporator, where the evaporator coil absorbs heat from the external cooling medium before going back into the absorber, and the process continues. So this is how the absorption chiller works. So to wrap it up, in this video, I've shown you what chillers are, and I've also shown you how compression chiller and absorption chiller works. In my next video, I will show you some of the factors to consider when selecting the different working fluids for your absorption chiller. And subsequently, I will show you how to model the performance of the absorption chiller. I hope you find this video helpful. Please hit the like button and subscribe, and see you in the next one. Thank you for watching.